Graham Greene would have loved Dilly. UN workers mixed with carpetbaggers, diplomats, hopeful locals, and the military boys in green. Gone is the romantic terrain of the liberation struggle. Now, it's the hard reality of post-independent survival. Timor became independent in 2002, and it's this man, Prime Minister Mari Alkatiri, who wields the power, not the internationally famous Janana Guzmão or José Ramos Horta. Alkatiri carries a heavy burden. He must oversee the reconstruction of his country, shattered by Indonesia's occupation. After decades of the independence struggle, Alkatiri makes it clear the struggle continues. But now it's about economic independence.
We fought 24 years for an independent country, and we will still fight for an independent country. And independent means sovereignty over all our resources.
Mari Alkatiri led the Fretilin party to victory in countrywide elections in 2001. Before that, he viewed his country's tough struggle for liberation from the outside.
Since the invasion of East Timor, Jakarta is facing a lot of troubles.
He spent 24 years in exile as part of the Fretilin diplomatic struggle abroad, living mainly in Mozambique, one of the few countries to provide generous support to the resistance. He was a founding and well-regarded member of Fretilin. His tough negotiation skills are a crucial asset as the young leaders fought for diplomatic recognition around the world. He's a Muslim in Catholic East Timor, so his elevation to the top job is no small feat after years overseas. But today, after only a year in the hot seat, he's under attack from critics both inside and outside the country. Old political enemies are now jostling for power. A short distance from the Prime Minister's office, one of his strongest political opponents, Mario Carrascalau, is being threatened with eviction from the house he's lived in since Portuguese rule. Carrascalau is crying foul, saying the government is playing dirty politics.
In order to destroy this, you know, you have to destroy their political leaders. Destroy politically by creating the mistrust of the people, the non-confidence of the people, then create a situation like this.
Carrascalau and his supporters accuse Alkatiri's government of corruption and nepotism. It's political sledging time, and Alkatiri's years in exile are used against him. He's cast as an outsider. Emotions are running high, and the Cold War rhetoric is out in force. The political divide that existed before Indonesia invaded in 1975 has re-emerged between Fretilin socialists and their opposition. The Carrascalaus have always opposed Fretilin, calling them communists. In this political time warp, Mario's brother Manuel doesn't mince words. Today in the district of Lao Tem, security is intense, ahead of a visit by the Prime Minister to meet the people. It's part of something called open government, after critics accused him of being uncommunicative and out of touch. Alkatiri is also fending off criticism that he's running a government of exiles, people who've returned but didn't stay to fight during the struggle. It's not long before he addresses the issue of legitimacy. Alkatiri's house was burned to the ground during these riots on December 4 last year. Two people died in unrest that shocked the new nation, violence and looting carrying on for over 6 hours. Many saw it as a direct attack on the Prime Minister. The unrest, a rude wake-up call for this young government. The Prime Minister also believes the riot was politically motivated.
Do you take the threats to your power seriously? And I suppose I'm looking at December 4th. Do you see that as an example of an attempt to lessen your power?
Yeah, from very few people in this country. They were trying because they thought at that time that I will really react negatively. It means that react negatively, I could do one of the two things: to call to the Fretilin members to come out and to react. It will be a disaster. It will be a disaster. Or simply tell to the people, I'm going. Choose another person to govern this country. I'm tired of. But I decided not to do either one of these options and to stay.
While there have been numerous investigations into the riots, no one has been charged, leading to furious speculation in a country used to the whispers of an underground resistance. Constant rumours of a military coup seem to preoccupy many of the locals, and today at Lao Tem, the head of the military, Taumat Ruak, addresses them head on. He says the army is with the government, and that unrest is coming from groups outside the army.
Who is not being a part of the government is not, it's not real the army. Maybe some bands or groups.
The bandits he's referring to are ex-guerrillas, who, according to the constant rumour mill, are massing against the government. After lunch, the influential president of the parliament, Luolo, and a former guerrilla leader, Lere, discuss the so-called third force. It's hard to know in Timor today where to separate truth and fiction. However, these seemingly fantastical scenarios do play into some real political divisions. For example, there is real discontent inside his party about Alkatiri's leadership. A petition is circulating within Fretilin to remove him and the party president Luolo. And at this meeting, Alkatiri lets the comrades know what he thinks. And over lunch, at a resort built by the seaside, other urgent pressures are revealed. President Guzmão has recently rejected a controversial immigration bill put forward by Alkatiri's government. The bill is opposed by the international community in Timor, who say it reflects Alkatiri's suspicion of foreigners. Guzmão's rejection has raised the ire of the government and added to existing tension between the two leaders. The immigration law debate is just one of the pressures Alkatiri is facing. He's also coming under criticism for being protectionist over Timor's development, critics saying his cautious approach is hindering the country's future. Here, he's visiting a stream earmarked for a hydroelectricity project. And he makes it clear there'll be no fly-by-nights making money at Timor's expense. Travelling across Timor, it's easy to see why the country is considered one of the world's poorest. Many are advocating fast-track development, saying concessional loans from large international institutions, such as the Asian Development Bank and World Bank, would kickstart the economy. But Alkatiri is resisting the pressure, saying future oil money is enough, and that loans would send the country down a dangerous path of recurring debt.
Because loans, you have to pay back the loan. And if you don't use the money, the loans money, it will be a disaster for this country.
But this softly, softly approach isn't supported by other senior leaders in Timor. Foreign Minister José Ramos Horta says he wouldn't be so suspicious of loans or foreign investment. He'd do things differently.
I would move faster to enter into agreements with potential foreign investors, give them facilities, privileges, so that they begin investing. You know, I wouldn't spend too much time in worrying about all the legal implications.
He does add, however, that there may be sense in a cautious approach.
The Prime Minister is a lawyer. He is a very suspicious character by nature. He is even suspicious of his own shadow. And that's positive. You know, as we are building the country, someone has to be extremely careful. If things go much, much slowly, well, maybe at least it goes slowly, but it goes safely, steadily, rather than we make quick decisions, improvising and creating a chaos, a mess.
Others are not so generous. João Saldanha is from the East Timor Study Group, a think tank that advocates privatisation and free market ideals. I caught up with him after he'd met with the acting US ambassador.
We're trying to isolate East Timor from the rest of the world. Well, we're a small country. I don't think we can afford to do that.
It's hard to see once forgotten Timor shutting out the international community. There are plenty of players here in Dili, the World Bank, the UN, and Australia, just to name a few. But it is the nature of connections that Alkatiri is forging that concerns Saldanha.
There is a shift in this government. There is some attention, not much going to Australia, to US, to Japan, but I think it looks going to China.
When Alkatiri met with a Chinese delegation earlier this year, it gave more ammunition to his critics. They say the meeting was proof that the old Fretilin socialist hadn't changed his spots. But for Alkatiri, the meeting with a regional power just made good sense.
One of the biggest cooperation of some other countries in this region is with China. Even from other countries from out of this region, United States and European Union, a market like China, which is more than 1 billion people, consumers, everybody is looking for this market.
Alkatiri's Chinese connections are being closely watched by other regional players as the emerging superpower seeks to expand its influence in the Pacific. Timor's strategic position and oil and gas reserves make it an attractive ally for other powerful nations like Australia and the US.
Do we want East Timor to be a force for good in this region? Sure we do, in lots of ways.
But according to the US ambassador, Grover Joseph Rees, there's no big picture politics involved. He's just keeping an eye on a new democracy.
There are always temptations, and there are always, whether you're talking about a government, whether you're talking about individuals, we all have tendencies in ourselves that we need to keep in check. And that's just as true of this government as is of everybody else. And that's part of the reason that that the international community is here in larger numbers than they would be, say, in another country this size, is because this is a government in transition. And, you know, they were ruled for 24 years in a way that did include corruption and nepotism and brutality. And there are two lessons you can learn from that. One is, now that we have our freedom, we will never be like that. And you hear people saying that. And then the other lesson you can learn without even maybe knowing you learned the lesson is, oh, that's the way to behave when you get in charge.
From Mari Alkatiri, it's not about political morality, but a delicate geopolitical balancing act.
Timor-Leste is a very small country, situated between two big regional powers. It's not easy to be a small country. That's the reason why the only thing to survive, the only way to survive in this condition is to be independent and to play a very active role as a bridge between the two giants.
But the looming battle between the great powers counts for very little alongside Alkatiri's immediate domestic struggles. The Prime Minister says he will continue the job he started long ago in the resistance, taking orders from the people and the party now running a liberated Timor.
This is my obligation. I have to make my contribution for the liberation of the people from poverty and from illiteracy. All kind of things I have to do first. And I'm here not because I love to be in power. I'm here because people asking me, Fretilin is still asking me to stay. Once in the Central Committee Fretilin decided to choose another person, I will support it and I will be happy.